And are they aware that they've got a legend in their midst?
Oh, they don't give a shit. And that's what's so good about it.
Really?
French people are too posh, aren't they? I mean, have you ever been to Paris? They treat you abominably. Oh,
welcome to Putting It Together, the podcast that goes through the entire body of work of Stephen Sondheim, show by show, and song by song. My name is Kyle Marshall, your self-described Sondheim expert. And right from the very top here, I played a little clip there at the beginning of the episode, but a huge condolence to the family, the friends of the late, great Diana Rigg, who passed away here this week. I do think that for a lot of people, that people will know her as Lady Olenna from the Game of Thrones series, although for some of us, we might remember her from the Avengers, I think 1960s, 70s British show, not the superheroes. Although she was kind of a superhero to me. She was a Bond girl, she did musicals, she was in the film version of A Little Night Music, and that's absolutely saying nothing about her being a friend and a mother and all the things she did outside of the entertainment industry, so just a big thank you to what she has given to the world. This week we're talking about the story of Lucy and Jessie, and hilariously enough, we get to it pretty soon when I'm talking with Victoria about how I totally misinterpreted this song, so I can't wait for you to listen to that. Victoria has actually been here before. She did not come and talk about a song the last time she was here. Instead, she came in to talk about, generally, about how she interprets Sondheim music, how she was going to be doing a concert at the time. Of course, you know, COVID is happening, so it's kind of thrown a wrench into everybody's gears. Which is why I really need to thank my patrons, people over on the Patreon page, patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast, help make this show better and help make this show run. Of course, everyone is important, but I want to thank in particular the God That's Good tier, the Holy Triumvirate who's holding things down, Jack, Todd, and Barry. And if you would like to help support the show, I would, of course, very much appreciate that. But one way you can give to the show without giving any money is to go and rate and review this on whatever platform you're listening to it on. iTunes is the best, but for those of you who don't use that, then however you leave reviews, it really does help the show reach a wider audience. But now it's time for Plodding Along. Plotting Along, of course, is the part of the show where I describe to you what is happening in the plot. And once again, we are still inside the Psycho Follies. Each core character has a chance to have their solo, and it's now Phyllis's turn. She comes out with a bevy of background dancers to talk a little bit about her mental state. Okay, I'm going to go thank some sponsors, and then when I return, it'll be my conversation with Victoria Gordon about the story of Lucy and Jessie. Putting It Together is a proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network, locally grown, community supported. The Alberta Podcast Network promotes and supports Alberta-made podcasts and connects their audiences with Alberta-based businesses and organizations. Today, I want to tell you a little bit about ATB's new podcast, The Future Of. You can join Todd Hirsch, ATB's Vice President and Chief Economist, as he connects with special guests who offer unique and useful perspectives about the future. Explore how our economy and communities can not only brace for change, but embrace the opportunity it creates. From the future of women in business to the changing nature of work itself, The Future Of helps us understand what's coming and what we need to do today to get the tomorrow we want. Featuring 2 episodes each month, plus bonus episodes, The Future Of includes interviews with top community and business leaders from Alberta and around the world. Subscribe to The Future Of in the Apple Podcast Store, Google Play, Spotify, and everywhere podcasts are found, and connect to ask your questions about the future by emailing thefutureof@atb.com. This week we are also brought to you by the Alberta Podcast Network, so let's go and listen to one of our other great shows.
I'd like to get more reading done, and joining a book club seems like a good idea, but I don't know. why not?
Reading a whole book in a month, that's pretty daunting.
What if it was just a chapter, say, a week?
That doesn't sound too bad. Still, getting together with a bunch of people, that's a whole evening.
Well, what if it was only half an hour, whenever you wanted to?
That would be great.
The Read-Along, a mini book club for your ears.
Join my wife, Anita.
And my husband, Scott.
As we take you on a journey through a good book,
one chapter at a time.
A proud member of the Alberta Podcast Network.
Locally grown.
Community supported.
Available right now on your podcatcher of choice.
Here's a little story that should make you cry about two unhappy dames.
Victoria, thank you so much for coming back.
Thank you for having me back.
You know, you've been here before, of course, but I really want to jump into knowing what your history with Follies is.
Well, this is the funny thing. I grew up, as I've mentioned before to you, my mom was a really big Sondheim fan, and she had played in the pit orchestra of Little Night Music several times. So Little Night Music was like one of the big ones for us, Company, but for some reason, Follies in the Middle just never quite hit in my family. So it wasn't until I was in high school that I got into Follies because I thought the song Losing My Mind was a really gorgeous song. So I grew up. I was about 13 or 14 when I dug up the cast album from the 85 concert. Mm. And that was the one that I really like grew up on. And when I was in college, Follies came back to Broadway and then came to Los Angeles. And we had the same cast as the Broadway, except instead of Bernadette, we had Vicki Clarke as Sally. So my mom and I went on opening night to see it at the Amundsen. It's an interesting show because it's not like Company, it's not a linear story. And for my mom coming from a Little Night Music being like her first intro to Sondheim, she's always kind of shocked by the story situation in Sondheim shows. But for me, it was just, that's Sondheim.
Par for the course, yeah. What were the big songs though that you really fell in love with?
Well, again, having grown up with that recording, the 85 concert, instead of being the God, Why Don't You Love Me blues, it was Buddy's blues. And that's when Mandy did all three parts.
Yeah.
So to me, that was like a feat. And actually, it sort of screwed me up because it took me a long time to appreciate the song without the actor playing Buddy doing the entire thing. I was like, oh, come on, he's lazy if he's not doing the whole thing. But now I appreciate the nuance of that song. And I've always loved Who's That Woman? It's fun. And yet, the more I understand it, the more I feel like it's also kind of one of the saddest numbers in the show. When you think about what they're seeing and the reflection of what they were like, even if they were never as good as they are remembering themselves as having been, it's kind of bittersweet to look back and think, geez, I was that.
Well, I mean, that's the I think the best thing about this show is I've been discovering a lot. This is a Shrek reference, but it's like the layers of onion, right? Like, I mean, there's different things in this. And I think it's perfectly okay to look at these individual songs and like love just individual portions of them. I think it's one of those things that when you actually finally see the show performed, you really start to understand, oh, this is how everything interconnects with one another. And yeah. At least for me, I'll speak for myself. There were certain songs that I was like, felt like throwaway songs, but that do not feel like throwaway songs when you actually see it performed in the show itself. So it's great to see it actually as a performance.
Totally. I feel like One More Kiss, I was like, it's a pretty song. What's it doing here? And then when you actually see it in the show, it's one of the more enjoyable moments of the show. And I will give also to the Sopranos a salute. It gives two Sopranos a very nice chance to show off their skills, which is not always a thing. I mean, yes, he's had Joanna and he's had Ann Eggerman, but it's a really nice opportunity.
For you being a performer, which are the songs are your go-tos in a performance?
So March 22nd, it was supposed to be an in-person show and then the apocalypse happened.
Right.
I opened with Broadway Baby and then I did Losing My Mind. I think both of those songs have a different significance to me. Broadway Baby is just a blast. People who don't know the show at all can still appreciate that song and hum it. And that's rare for Sondheim. And then Losing My Mind is just a breakdown. And what I love is you've got this woman who looks better than she ever has in a beautiful setting, dressed beautifully, having a breakdown. And because it's so beautiful, you're distracted from the fact that this woman is literally falling apart in front of you. So as a performer, I just find that fun to go to, but I would love to, I think I'm too young. Could I Leave You is one that I really would love to try.
Yeah, I love that song a lot. I mean, this is a good segue because something we were talking about before I pushed record here is the Phyllis character in Follies and how much I have learned to really fall in love with that character. I don't know if you want to speak to that again about what are your feelings about Phyllis, the character in Follies?
Well, here's the thing. You have with the two different couples, you have four principal characters, and each one gets a number, and like a big solo number in each act. Really, the focus of the two couples, the two like main people, are Ben and Sally, and they get multiple songs. They have Too Many Mornings. They have this whole backstory of romance. Buddy somehow manages to worm his way into the story with the right girl. So he gets that first act number that really gives you a sense of what Buddy's grappling with. And then, of course, that plays back into the second act with Buddy's Blues of the God, Why Don't You Love Me, whichever blues he's doing. Then you have Phyllis, who does have a song in each act. She has Could I Leave You in the first act, which is a fantastic song. And then she has either The Story of Lucy and Jessie or All But Underneath in the second act. But you don't get that inner world from Phyllis in the first act. Could I Leave You is very much an outward song. It's her communicating her feelings about her marriage to her husband, kind of in a snarky, obnoxious way. Everyone else gets a chance to give you a sense of their inner conflict. That is not her inner conflict. That is their outer conflict. Right. And I feel like Phyllis gets ignored as a character in that way. At the same time, Phyllis is a really interesting character. And I feel like some of the actresses who've played Phyllis over the years have brought so many interesting levels to it. You have, I mean, obviously first there was Alexis Smith, Lee Remick was amazing. Even recently, Christine Baranski played the role in 2015, which, like, can you think of a better casting? I can't.
Right, right. Or
Jan Maxwell in the last Broadway revival, who was an unsung hero of that one, in my opinion. Phyllis is a character who deserves more than she gets, but by putting the right actress in the role, you can get her to, you can get more out of the character. It's just unfortunate that musically, she doesn't quite get to give us the inner glimpse until the end of the second act.
It's too bad that she is a bit lost in the shuffle when it comes to this, because it's a while before we really start to uncover more about her in the show, which is too bad. And every performance I've seen, like, you really have to rely on the actress who's doing this. Now, I will say something that came up in the recording I did with Losing My Mind is the story about how this song specifically even came about, which I find fascinating. I love this because, I mean, I guess you could look at this in two different ways. I am preferring to look at it in the positive light, which was that Losing My Mind was originally supposed to be a Phyllis song. And Alexis Smith said, I'm not really a singer. You should actually give this one to Dorothy Collins.
And it was a duet, I think. It was going to be kind of like, not that they were around the same time, but I know him so well. You know, they're both singing about Ben.
Yeah.
Alexis Smith, you know, you got to give her credit, though, because a lot of actresses would say, well, that could be my big moment, too. Why not take it? But she had the foresight and the decency to say, she can sing. I can't. Let her have the number. I'll do something else.
Right. Because he was like, I'm a much better dancer. So why don't you write a song where I can show off my dance skills? So Sondheim wrote this song, and it actually turned out to be more beneficial because, at least in the original run, more reviews mentioned like how great Alexis Smith is in her dance number in the second act, and nothing was much said about Dorothy, which is unfortunate. But so it played out better for her in the long run. But that's kind of why we get this doubling up here, Losing My Mind, and then we go into the story of Lucy and Jessie.
Well, you know, if they hadn't done that, though, we'd be complaining even more about Phyllis being ignored, because if all she had gotten was a duet. Also, I have to say, I don't think emotionally, ultimately, Losing My Mind fits with the journey that Phyllis goes on, which is, why would she be singing this song about a guy she basically tolerates?
Yeah, I agree. That's the biggest one for me. It's like, when you find out that thing, it's like, well, this doesn't feel like a Phyllis song, though. That's a Sally song.
I know. It's just, I think it's the only reason she gets any kind of, you know, she gets to be called one of the leads because they're the four principals, but if she didn't have a song in the second act and she just had a duet, I think we'd really be like, Phyllis is the forgotten character.
Right. Yeah. No, that's true. Well, we are talking about the story of Lucy and Jessie here today. I do want to give some credit to the actresses who have portrayed her. Now, the three versions of Follies that we're really focusing on this season, only two of them actually have this song. Because the fun thing is that, yes, this can be flipped out between another song called All But Underneath, depending on if they have cast Phyllis as a singer or a dancer. So it can kind of go back and forth. But we have the original Broadway cast, so that's Alexis Smith. We have the 1987 London version, which was played by Diana Rigg. So she does not sing this song. I'm going to put that up there. And then we have the 2017 National Theater version played by Janie D. So those are the three different performances. Now, Follies does have a lot of pastiche in it, of course. And so I just want to talk about what the inspirations are here. Sondheim writes in his book that this is very much in reference to Yip Harburg, where there is these rhyming consonants, but not really the vowel sounds. It's like the ends of words are rhyming, not necessarily like the whole word. So as an example, I just want to play this as an example so people can kind of get an understanding of it. Here is April in Paris. These are lyrics by Yip Harburg, music by Vernon Duke, and sung by Billie Holiday.
April in Paris, chestnuts in blossom, holiday tables under the trees. April in Paris, this is a feeling no one can ever reprise.
So that will give you a basis of what that sounds like. Do you have much of a knowledge of Yip Harburg?
Really mostly because for those out there who have not read either of Sondheim's books, he is a huge Yip Harburg fan.
Oh, yeah.
So my exposure comes from the fact that Sondheim talks about him so much that eventually I had to go out and investigate myself. But really, otherwise, he's not as much in my wheelhouse, but I do understand this sort of concept of the rhyming consonants and how that came from his style. So yes,
yeah.
I have some.
That's the only negative I can say about myself for a lot of these references, where like I know like kind of like the big hits by, say, like Gershwin or Irving Berlin or Noel Coward and stuff, but I don't have a deep, deep knowledge of these singer-songwriters. Mm-hmm. It's something that I need to get better at, I think. That being said, this is how the song starts. So Phyllis goes in, "Here's a little story that should make you cry about two unhappy dames. Let us call them Lucy X and Jessie Y, which are not their real names. Now Lucy has the purity along with the unsurety that comes from being only 21. Jessie has maturity and plenty of security. Whatever you can do with them, she's done. Given their advantages, you may ask why the two ladies have such grief. This is my belief in brief."
Here's a little story that should make you cry about two unhappy dames. Let us call them Lucy X and Jessie Y, which are not their real names. Now Lucy has the purity along with the unsurety that comes with being only 21. Jessie has maturity and plenty of security. Whatever you can do with them, she's done. Given their advantages, you may ask why the two ladies have such grief. This is my belief in brief.
So from that first section, is there anything that jumps out at you at all?
You know, it's kind of interesting. When I first heard this song when I was in high school, I don't think the concept of Lucy and Jessie as being two separate sides of one individual's personality or two separate, like, I don't think it made sense to me, because when you're in high school, I mean, you haven't experienced that much of life. You can't, I mean, yes, you can think of yourself as like the child you and then the adult or the teenage you.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, it's like I look back at myself now in high school and I understand the concept of the Lucy and the Jessie, you know, the who you were and the who you've become. And I think Phyllis really having this sort of split personality, again, this is where Phyllis not having this sort of first act number makes her a bit of a shocker. It's like, does she have multiple personalities? Does she just really, is she reminiscing about who she was? I think I tend to believe it's more of a reminiscence, although they're all falling apart in the second act, so it could be any number of things.
Right.
But it's really interesting how she sort of separates it out as such a binary. This is who she was at 21, or this is who Lucy is. This is who Jessie is. This is who she is now. And it's like there is no overlap in her mind between who she was and who she's become.
That's such a great call out, because I have to tell you that only 21 line has always confused me, in that I always assumed what this song was actually saying was that she was making this big distinction between herself and Sally, and like that was like the fake names. I think that's a lot of readings have it, but I actually like that reading better. It's actually herself, her now versus her as a younger woman, and those like two roles kind of fighting back and forth with each other, which actually makes the song make more sense, to be honest with you.
Well, you know, it's a tough one. I think this goes back to the fact that Sondheim is a genius, and sometimes he might not realize that not everyone watching is as much of a genius as he is, because I think a lot of people naturally, and I mean, I myself was like, well, one's Lucy, one's Sally and one's Phyllis. but that doesn't quite line up.
Mm-hmm.
So you know, thinking of it as two separate sides of one woman, although again, as a person, and you're a person as well, so you understand this, it doesn't require being a woman, that who you were makes you who you are. You can't right. separate your past from your present the way this song does. It's almost too neat a separation. And it makes me very curious about Phyllis's intervening 30 years, because to act as though her past self is not even part of what she has become today, or not even an influence on who she is really shocking.
Yeah, you know, I think that's the biggest thing too. And like the older you get, you really understand, it's like, absolutely, I do believe that people can change over time, but your past also influences who you are today. There's no way around that. The choices you made or the experiences you had, even if you're trying to escape something or change your life, the fact that you had to go through that still influences you in your present day, and absolutely. It always will.
Absolutely.
I do want to call it some of the rhyme schemes are going on here. So we mentioned before about how it's like the endings of words and stuff like that, rather than like the entire word necessarily rhyming. So you have a little bit of that here. So there's like purity and surety, maturity, security is kind of like the biggest rhyme scheme that's going on here. Mm-hmm. But even like grief, belief, brief, like it's really hitting the, like those F's, like he's trying to get those F's in there as much as he can. This when the song starts, and when I first listened to it, it sounded very much like a lounge act, for lack of a better word. Mm-hmm. Like I could see like the smoke coming out and like the microphones, like, let me tell you a story about what's going on here. I really want to know actually how much time it takes to like really like, where are all the words that end in Y? Let me see, let's draw it out, and let's figure out how I can map these in and how it all fits. I mean, Sondheim has always been accused a little bit of like almost like a puzzle master, like putting pieces where they need to be put. But I think this is a good example of that, of like really fitting things into where they need to go.
And what's kind of interesting too, going with those rhymes, is that you have the four rhymes, but these lines are sets of three.
Mm-hmm.
Purity, unsurety, 21. That's one triad. Maturity, security, done. Second triad. But he's got the four rhymes. I find that kind of interesting that he would set that up. I guess the way he thought of it was 2-1-2-1. Because then he goes with grief, belief, and brief, and that's another set of three. So it's kind of an interesting mathematical structure too, because like it doesn't quite, it's like four doesn't quite fit with three, but I guess if you think of it as 2-1, I don't know. That kind of intrigues me, just thinking about how he had to come up with different numbers of words to fit this sort of three-line structure.
So here in this next section, you'll really start to see how it's not like perfect rhymes are happening, but it feels like there's rhymes happening here too. So she continues on and she sings, Lucy is juicy, but terribly drab. Jessie is dressy, but cold as a slab. Lucy wants to be dressy. Jessie wants to be juicy. Lucy wants to be Jessie, and Jessie, Lucy, you see. Jessie is racy, but hard as a rock. Lucy is lacy, but dull as a smock. Jessie wants to be lacy. Lucy wants to be Jessie. That's a sorrowful pressy. It's very messy. Sorry, sad souls, itching to be switching roles. Lucy wants to do what Jessie does. Jessie wants to be what Lucy was.
Lucy is juicy, but terribly drab. Jessie is dressy, but cold as a slab. Lucy wants to be dressy. Jessie wants to be juicy. Lucy wants to be Jessie. And Jessie, Lucy, you see, Jessie is racy, but hard as a rock. Lucy is lacy, but dull as a smock. Jessie wants to be lacy. Lucy wants to be Jessie. That's the sorrowful bracy. It's very messy. Ooh, sad souls, itching to be switching roles. Lucy wants to do what Jessie does. Jessie wants to be what Lucy was.
So that's a mouthful. It feels like I'm going to like fail.
I was going to say, it wasn't until, I don't know if you remember this or even heard this recording, but B.B. Newworth did a recording in, I want to say like 2011 or 2012 of this song for an album of hers. I think it was her first solo album.
Mm-hmm.
And that was when I realized this song is just a tongue twister.
It is.
This album has a lot of work. I mean, clearly if you're going to play Phyllis, you have to be able to handle all the words in Could I Leave You and all the words in this one. But these are really just like, I would love to hear the outtakes. I'm sure there are outtakes.
Oh, it has to be. I mean, with the, and Sondheim has written about this before, not about this song specifically, but he mentions about like the biggest trick, and it's really hard as a songwriter to pull this off, which is to have essentially like a tongue twister, like weird language, but for it still to be easy to be sung. Which you're not intentionally trying to make the actor fail, which you can sometimes get into, say, like when you think about Gilbert and Sullivan, which almost sometimes they are intentionally hard to sing for the actor to like hit those and not get tongue tied and lost in the lyrics themselves. So to point it out here, juicy, dressy, Jessie, Lucy, you see, like none of those are necessarily like perfect rhymes, but it all kind of fits. Like he's hitting those like the sea line is what it's really important here, and why it's like that's the reference to Harburg that we were mentioning before.
And it's such a departure from Sondheim's usual, like, perfect rhymes are the perfect thing to put it. I mean, he's so into the perfect rhymes that it's almost surprising, but it's so close and it matches. It's not like, I'm not naming names of any current singers, but there are a lot of singers right now who use imperfect rhymes deliberately. It's not that. It's just that it's not what we're used to as a perfect Sondheim rhyme.
No, for sure. I don't know. From this section that we're talking about, anything that jumps out at you specifically?
Well, you know, again, this comes back to thinking about it from the perspective of character. Phyllis clearly has a very low sense of self-worth.
Oh, yeah.
Because not only does she think she's a mess now, she thinks she was a mess then. One line from the first act of the show, there's actually a scene in the first act right before Loveland where the couples are arguing, but there's also an argument from the past. Mm. And Phyllis is looking at her past self arguing and she's saying, you were perfect then. Like she's looking at herself saying she's not much now, but she'll make herself something. She's like, but you were so good then. So Phyllis can clearly see that she was not, you know, just this awful, boring, wet rag. But somehow when she actually starts to talk it through, she makes it seem as though she is like this unredeemably, just miserably boring person. And coming at it from a perspective of character, it's a really interesting thing because it's in this song that otherwise is very peppy. And if you're not paying close attention to the lyrics, it almost seems like this is kind of a fun, bouncy, happy number. But you're dealing with a woman who is really in the throes of some bad mental health issues. And hearing it with hearing it disconnected as we're speaking, the lyrics is a little different. But hearing it in the context of the song, it's very much a dichotomy, not all that different from Losing My Mind.
You know, something that I've really been focusing on here the last few weeks, delving into Follies, but really getting into more of like Sondheim's biography and his whole catalog. It's not necessarily something that happens in every show, but there is a tendency to have these characters that really focus on like their past is like something that is like a big cross to bear for them. And I haven't fully formalized my argument here, but it's almost like he understands something that I think is very true today that I see as a negative, which is like this rising up of nostalgia, meaning like, oh, the past was always, it was so much better 20, 30 years ago, except it wasn't. Like, we have this like idealized version of what that past was because you were like younger and you didn't have to worry about all the bad things that were going on in the world. So there's always this like dichotomy, like, oh, like my younger self or my past, like that was when everything was perfect, everything was good, except you're also conveniently forgetting about all the other stuff that you were dealing with. I think Phyllis is a good example of that, which is like, she's putting this like, oh, like this amazing 21-year-old, like maybe slightly naive, but it was like, it was better stuff then, except you're not remembering all the stuff that might've been negative about that too. And it's like completely consuming her because she's convinced that the past was better when I don't know if it actually was.
That's the thing. I'm not sure she is. I think she might've been in the first act, but by this song, she's made it pretty clear to us as the audience that Lucy's not perfect. Lucy's got some benefits over Jessie. You know, she's clearly a much more open, happier person, but she's also basically, she's dull as a slab. I mean, she's not interesting at all. Whereas she sees herself, I mean, she almost sees it as a choice, a binary, which I find fascinating. It's either you get to be interesting and fun. No, you get to be fun, but completely uninteresting, or you get to be a sophisticated person with no emotions. And it's kind of just an interesting...
Yeah, I guess that's maybe the important thing is like there's this binary that she's put up in her mind, which I guess she's convinced herself is true, but I don't think it is. I don't think that that's how the world necessarily is, where you have to be only this or this other thing. I think this would fully come into effect. I keep bringing this up weirdly in this season, even though I don't think they're necessarily like super similar, but Into the Woods has like that dichotomy of like and or, right? Like we have that, why does it always have to be an and never or? And I think that she's stuck in her or. Like, it can only be this or this way. And there's no way to, like, combine those two together.
Oh, yeah. No, she's a very rigid character, which is part of why, again, the casting of Phyllis is so important. Because since so much of this doesn't show up till the end of the second act, you have to cast an actress who makes you think of the right person. Otherwise, people are just going to be like, I don't know who this is.
Right. Now, because I'm a big old dummy, I had to look this up because I actually didn't quite know what Precis meant. So P-R-E-C-I-S. In context, I kind of could understand it, but it's like, I actually don't know exactly what that means. Jessie wants to be Lacey. Lucy wants to be Jessie. That's the sorrowful Precis. It's very messy. So Precis just means a concise or like a short summary of something.
Yeah, I know that. This is actually kind of a stupid story. I had always heard that, and I speak French, and I didn't really know what it meant in the context, so I just moved on.
Yeah.
When I was in college, we had a class where we had a paper, because what else do you do in college? And we had to turn in a pressie for a paper. And I was like, oh my God, that's what it is. So it was a big eye opener. I was like the only
like big light bulb moment. Yeah.
I'm like, it's summertime. People are like, what? I was an art history major. It had nothing to do with the sun. But it definitely, that was when that clicked in my mind. So I know how you feel.
So the next very short section, Phyllis goes on, Lucy's a lassie. You pat on the head. Jessie is classy, but virtually dead. Lucy wants to be classy. Jessie wants to be lassie. If Lucy and Jessie could only combine, I could tell you someone who would finally feel just fine.
Lucy's a lassie, you pat on the head. Jessie is classy, but virtually dead. Lucy wants to be classy. Jessie wants to be lassie. If Lucy and Jessie could only combine, I could tell you someone who would finally feel. I could tell you someone who would finally feel. I could tell you someone who would finally feel just fine.
I am assuming, and correct me if I'm wrong, like the lassie that they're talking about is like the dog lassie in this case. Like that's what I'm assuming. Although I do, you don't necessarily, you don't have to read that, but.
No, that's an interesting point. I kind of like that because you pat on the head. I kind of thought it was like a little kid, you know, like, oh, she's so adorable. But no, you're right. The dog makes a lot more sense.
Well, the only thing that makes it confusing, and this could be a printing error, I don't know. But like, if you look at the lyrics, the way that they're written, the first time he writes it, Lucy's a lassie, that's a lowercase L. And then when it comes back, Jessie wants to be lassie, it's an uppercase L. So it's like. Yeah. I don't know if he's intentionally trying there to be a bit confusion. It's like her as a little girl, as a lass, or her being like the famous dog Lassie, which would absolutely have been known in 1971, like had been in television for like 15 years or something like that at that point. So definitely would have been understood. Anyways, an interesting analogy of all things, like a faithful kind of servant almost.
But also kind of very Sondheim, given his pop culture love, which gets so often because he's such a deep, you know, everything's so deep and serious, but he loves pop culture. So it almost seems like he might have been deliberate.
But I think this really leads credence to what we've been talking about here. And like I said, why this starts to make more sense. I'll share with you this, like in my notes I had written for this, is like, I always get confused by this song. And like what the actual point is that she's trying to make. But now that we've broken it down as it being two sides of herself, it makes more sense. Because if Lucy and Jessie could only combine, I could tell you someone who would finally feel just fine. So I really feel that's more narratively rich than it being actually about Phyllis and Sally coming together for being one person.
This part, I think, is more identifiable than the idea that we're two separate people, you know, who we were and who we are. More the sense of, if only I could take the good parts of my youth, you know, the things that, you know, my lack of inhibition, my whatever things, because we all have things that we were better at when we were younger. My ability to let go.
Yeah, I had way better hair back then, so.
I mean, there's something for everyone. And if only we could bring that over into who we are now. And that's the first time that I think Phyllis's struggle is more reasonable and in line with the actual human situation. Because it's true. I mean, there's definitely something in all of us or outside all of us, depending on what you're talking about, that could really enhance who we are today. And it's like, if we could just, you know, if I could just be the person I am now with that one thing I was as a kid, which I hate to always say, like, well, there's just one thing that would make a difference, but I could be myself with like my, you know, lack of filter at that age, which that's a bad example, but you know what I mean? I would be like the most amazing person today. Although again, lack of filter, probably not, but that's what's relatable, is this sense of, if I could take the good from then and bring it into who I am now. And I think a lot of times those things are things we lose just by nature. Like I was saying earlier, inhibition. When you're a kid, you're not scared of anything.
Right.
And as you get older, you start to learn about things and you have fears. Or like when you're a kid and you have 20 bucks, so you go to the mall and you spend 20 bucks. Now, as an adult, when you have 20 bucks, you're like, okay, 401k.
Right, right.
For retirement, never touching that $20 again. It's like, if you could just take some of those fun, less worry-filled elements of your youth and bring them to the present. The problem is, she seems to think of it as, geez, I was awesome, except that I was actually really boring. So if I could be my interesting self, but like the awesome person I was, like, she really just wants to be like Superwoman. And she's not quite, that's a little bit beyond what I think this can be.
Now, you might know better than I do if this is just artistic choice or not, but in the original Broadway cast, like, she sings exactly what we just said there. I could tell you someone who would finally feel just fine, but in the 2017 version, she actually repeats that three times. So it's like, I could tell you someone who would finally feel, I could tell you someone who could finally feel, and finally finishes that sentence off completely. But I don't know. Do you know if that's done most of the time?
You know, what's interesting is in the 85, I think they repeat, if I could tell you someone who would finally feel just fine, just fine, just fine, three times. The original cast album of Follies is not
the best.
My favorite.
Yeah.
I think there are some great performances on it, but I don't think it necessarily is indicative of the show at large. And I think, especially for a show as confusing and big as Follies, the album doesn't necessarily give it the credit it deserves. So it wouldn't shock me if it was just the kind of thing where like, okay, we got one take, do the song. Great, sounds good, move on next, which is very common in the 60s and 70s. And that, I mean, it could have been any number of things. She might have really just been like, I don't want to sing. Like, that's a singing line. I'll do it once, but
yeah,
I'm not totally sure.
Yeah. So I think for whatever reason, there seems to be a little bit of artistic license in that little last little bit. Regardless, this is then when what they say the chorus kind of comes in, this being part of like this Psycho Follies section. So there's a lot of dance numbers and stuff going on. This, of course, is cut out from the original Broadway cast. Doesn't exist because the song ends exactly where we just finished. But there is another section that actually is supposed to be there. And it goes now with the chorus singing, "Now if you see Lucy X, youthful, truthful Lucy X, let her know she's better than she suspects. Now if you see Jessie Y, faded, jaded Jessie Y, tell her that she's sweller than apple pie. Juicy, Lucy, dressy, Jessie, tell them that they ought to get together quick, because getting it together is the whole trick."
Now if you see Lucy X, youthful, truthful Lucy X, let her know she's better than she suspects. Now if you see Jessie Y, faded, jaded Jessie Y, tell her that she's sweller than apple pie. Juicy Lucy, dressy Jessie, tell her that they ought to get together quick, cause getting it together is the whole trick, yeah!
Alright, so, in this final section here, how do you feel about the chorus?
Well, you know, what's interesting is you say it's the final section, and most recordings, it is the final, but I feel like in the 85, and I could be so off base here, they put that in, did the dance break, and then came back with Lucy's Alas, You Pat on the Head.
Oh, interesting.
So I moved around a few times and sort of adjusted to see where it's going to fit best. But it's a really interesting perspective because she's the only one who really gets that sort of outside boost. You know, if you have Buddy, he's got the God, Why Don't You Love Me blues in most versions, even in Buddy's blues. There's nobody there to tell him you're fine. Like, it's all in his head. Losing My Mind is 100% a solo number, perfect that way. Live, Laugh, Love coming up is all in his head too. And even though there's a chorus in there, it's almost like he's hearing voices. This could be seen as outside validation. It could be seen as in her head, but I just don't buy that. I think it's a form of external validation of like, hey, you're being really hard on yourself here. Like, just take a step back. You weren't bad then, you're not bad now, but if you could try to embrace some of that uninhibited youthful side, it might be good for you. So I think the chorus is a nice addition. And also I think it's nice that from having read Sondheim's book, he tried to give her chorus boys like three times. So that he finally got to remember with the chorus boys is just in and of itself a very nice achievement.
Who will speak for the chorus boys? Yeah, I just like, this does feel like the someone coming out in like a Shakespeare thing and being like, by the way, this is the meaning of the show that you just watched. The type of thing that happens. And this kind of feels what the chorus is like. So all the stuff that she's saying, let's just rephrase it once more time. Lucy X, Jessie Y, they should get together and that's going to make a whole better person type of thing.
Well, here's kind of an interesting thought that I just had as we're discussing this sort of Shakespeare, and I'm thinking Greek chorus. Do you think this goes back to Sondheim's sort of lifelong obsession with Allegro, the Gerald Rodgers and Hammerstein musical, which had that kind of chorus? I wonder if there's some tie in there. And I did not think of that until we started having this conversation. But
I think so. I mean, Sondheim even writes about that. It's like, you even subconsciously sometimes he realizes that he's trying to rewrite Allegro. And I think that was actually a Cameron McIntosh line to him. It's like, you're always trying to rewrite Allegro. And I think there's a little bit of truth to that. It's like, I'm going to make this chorus thing work.
Well, spoiler alert for those ready for next season, you're going to get to talk a lot about the chorus next season on A Little Night Music.
Correct, yes. Which, like, just as a quick aside, as a little teaser for that, as growing up, like, that's always how I felt about the Miller's son. It's like, what a weird way to end the show, about like someone just coming out like, by the way, here's the theme of the show again in like one song, and from this kind of like outside observer character.
That one's a fascinating one, because I mean, without getting too off track here, every character in that song and that show had a song that got cut at some point, but somehow that one stayed in. You think about all the songs. My mom did a production of it where they added back in silly people, and she was like, it was the longest, most boring part of the show. But the Miller's son just stayed.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. What do you like about this song in general?
You know, it's funny. I always hear, oh, this is this dancer's version, and then but underneath is the singer's version. And as a primarily singer who dances as opposed to a dancer who sings, I would pick this song over that one, hands down. Because I just feel that it really does provide some strong insight into who Phyllis is and what the actress playing Phyllis needs to communicate throughout the rest of the show to make that clear. She's someone who is very rigid in her beliefs, who has created an identity that she's worked very hard to present, but now is questioning whether that was the right choice. And I think this song conveys that better than All But Underneath.
Yeah.
And I also just think it's a more fun number. Like, I feel like in a night that is otherwise somewhat heavy, even though there are many lighthearted moments and numbers, it's a good breakup of the otherwise, you know, kind of confusing second act. I think it's a number that doesn't necessarily translate as well into solo shows. So it never is going to be Losing My Mind. It's never going to be Broadway Baby, even to a lesser extent, Could I Leave You? Because it's going to, putting this into a solo show is very difficult. I was even impressed when Bebe Neuwirth did it on her album. Mm-hmm. But I think it's such a great reflection of Phyllis's mental state and Phyllis's sense of self that I think it gives the audience the much needed and much deserved glimpse into who Phyllis is.
Yeah, I that's another good point that you just brought up. I think that if you look at the structure here at the last little bit of this show, where each of the principals is having like a their individual song, like you could argue you could do this a bunch of different ways. All four of them could be kind of like depressing or like pretty like heavy to get through. They could all be light and fluffy and fun with like a harder edge. Or you can kind of do what they did, which is like you have Buddy's Blues, which is kind of like fun, but like, you know, there's some meaning behind there. Losing My Mind is very much like that, like we are getting into deep stuff. This is the fun number, and then we get back to Live, Laugh, Love, which is kind of like both. Like you have, it starts off fun and then kind of goes tragic at the end. So it's an interesting way that they kind of combined all these four songs to hopefully have a bit of a flow to them instead of having the same tone for each of them.
It's an interesting second act. Follies is a very top-heavy show. The first act, all the story, all the exposition, plenty of music. And then the second act is actually comparatively very short and very light on story. And yet I think it gives everyone a moment to shine. Well, everyone in the four principals, a moment to shine. And I think it kind of ties it together nicely. I do wonder why it isn't presented as a one act, except that maybe it's just way too long to be a one act. And I can't imagine a Sondheim one act, but at the same time, it has that feel to it.
Well, it's interesting because there's actually a bit of debate about this. So the original Follies absolutely was a one act, like 2.5 hours straight through. The 2017 National Theater version was also that way. They did it without an intermission. But there's been a bunch of Follies versions that do have an intermission. And boy, does it change where they put that intermission, depending on the show. So some do it right after Too Many Mornings. Some of them do it after... right before Loveland or something like that, which feels weird to me to put it there.
Yeah.
The weirdest one that I heard, which does not make any sense to me because it's so early in the show, but there's some performances that did it in the middle of Who's That Woman? So basically, you do the first half of Who's That Woman, curtain comes down, intermission, you come back and they finish that number and the rest of the show happens. I'm like, that is bizarre. No. That is the most bizarre thing to do.
I do like the idea of right after Too Many Mornings. The 2011 Broadway and 2012 national tour was right after You're Gonna Love Tomorrow.
Mm-hmm.
It was also, I believe, when the 87 did the intermission. But that's just, I mean, by the time you sat through all that, you come back for like 35 minutes max.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, it's such
It's odd. It's a very odd time. But unions, I'm not sure why they would throw that intermission in.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing, too, I think I've said this on the show before, but talking about it being like, very plot heavy at the beginning. I've always heard like Follies, it's like Company, where there's really not a plot throughout the show. And like the first 40 minutes happen, I'm like, I don't know. It feels like there's a lot of plot going on. And then of course the rest of the show happens. I'm like, oh, I see what you're talking about. There's very little at the second half. So but the lead up to there, yes, very plot heavy, and then nothing for a good hour and a half.
Definitely. But the other thing that I think makes people think it has no plot is that it's fragmented. It's not like a straightforward, here's a story. It's like we're remembering certain things. You know, memory is kind of fickle. We have these moments where people are conversing now. I think, and now that there is talk of it being made into a film, which
right.
Imelda Staunton would make a great Sally, so you better get on that, people. I think what is going to have to happen is they're going to have to really fill in those sort of memory segments, which is going to take away some of what we all appreciate about Follies, but at the same time, a movie-going audience is not going to get it. It's not going to make a lot of sense in that sort of more fragmented, less plot. I mean, a movie has to have a plot. It just does.
Weirdly, I think that there is a way. I've been really thinking about this with like the movie announcement, and it's like the only area of my life that I'm super cynical in, which is like, I don't believe a movie's being made until it's actually being shot, and not even then, like, sometimes.
Speaking as someone who works in entertainment and in Los Angeles, there is no movie until you have a script and are on set shooting. And even then, there are plenty of stories I've heard of movies that have been shut down. Mm-hmm. You really have to be very, I think the announcement on this one was a little premature, whereas Merrily, they didn't actually announce that it was happening until I believe they had filmed the first scene.
Right. Yeah. Which I really want to be alive in 19 years when that comes out.
19 years. That's the thing, is all these things are getting pushed now. See, actually, Follies is in a good place because whoever's writing it, and I forgot who's doing the script, now has time to sit home and write.
Yeah. Well, what I'm hoping, like, if they called me up and asked me advice, which they absolutely should, but if they were to phone me and ask for advice, what I actually think is that, yes, I know it's called Follies, but if you're making this to be a movie, I think there's some very clear things. This will work even better in a movie and being able to use like camera techniques and tricks. But I'm wondering if they need to actually subvert it to being maybe not about the Follies, being something that's set in, if you're doing it in current day at least, and doing it about like old Hollywood. Kind of subvert it that way.
You've read about the original Follies movie.
Yeah, I think that was one of the treatments was, right? Where it was talking about like old time Hollywood is how they adapted it.
For that movie was to have, actually it was going to be Gene Kelly and Debbie Reynolds as Buddy and Sally, which is pretty awesome. And they were going to be gathering on a soundstage, or like, I believe a backlot that was going to be torn down. And they were going to treat it as a bunch of movie stars, aging movie stars, instead of aging theater stars. And the movie, for whatever reason, I don't remember the exact story, didn't happen. But one of the people who was involved in production on that movie was like, hey, this idea of a bunch of old stars circulating is kind of an interesting idea. What if we took that and took some old movie clips and put that together and made a movie? And so that became That's Entertainment.
Right, right.
Really, that movie that did not happen really inspired what has become a classic. So I feel like if they're going to go down that road again, they better not screw this up. They better, if they're going to do that, which I think is a fantastic idea, actually make it happen. Like, don't just take it and make another movie.
Make that movie. They have to hopefully find some like really good dancers and stuff like that. I mean, the fact that we almost had Gene Kelly dancing makes me upset that it never happened. But
Gene Kelly would have been so good. Oh, yeah. Just the image of her singing Losing My Mind.
Now, you maybe slightly answered this already, but I like to ask people, what is your favorite recording of this song? Could be of the three that we're talking about or any of them. What is your favorite recording of this song in particular?
That's tough. Well, again, having Lee Remick be my main exposure initially will always make that my favorite in some ways, because I think that's how I associated it. That was my baseline. So that helps make that one of my favorites. I recently came across the Christine Baranski from 2015, which is really hard to find. It wasn't like a cast album. It was a one-night concert, but she is the perfect Phyllis. Mm-hmm. And her recording is fantastic. And she's one where, again, it's interesting that she chose this song instead of Ovid Underneath, because I don't really think of Christine Baranski as a dancer.
Right.
So I'm kind of intrigued. It goes back to, I think this song is more of an illumination of who Phyllis is. And then I will say, again, I think Bebe Neuwirth did a really great job with it. She also would make a fantastic Phyllis. If anyone's casting a Phyllis right now, you can look at Bebe. But the truth is, this is a song that I feel like the actresses who played it, I mean, again, I saw Jan Maxwell do it in 2012. She was amazing. May she rest in peace.
Yeah.
I don't want to say it's hard to get wrong, but if you get Phyllis, it's hard to really mess this song up. It doesn't require, you know, there's no story of, oh, she hit the wrong note.
Right.
It's always going to be, you know, it's just the right actors bringing personality and bringing Phyllis into the song is going to make it fantastic. And luckily, we've been blessed with a lot of really great actresses in the role.
Mm-hmm. I will say here, too, like from the three that we are discussing, I am a big Alexis Smith fan, at least on this recording. Oh, and I keep talking about it, but Janie D is, I think, very good as Phyllis as well. I was over the moon with her Could I Leave You. I think she does a phenomenal performance of that song. So
Amazing. You know, it's interesting because I feel like the actress who plays Phyllis often gets the short end of the stick, kind of like Phyllis herself, because they tend to cast the sort of more famous person as Sally because you have someone you want to hear sing that money song. But Phyllis is just as interesting a character. And in fact, award-wise, not that awards are everything, Phyllis tends to do better than Sally. The actress playing Phyllis tends to get more nominations than the actress playing Sally. And so I think that she's kind of like the secret weapon of the show. If you're playing Phyllis, you have so much room to interpret that. And I have yet to really find one where I'm like, oh, what in the world is she doing? Whereas with Sally, sometimes, I mean, there are a lot of people who've done Losing My Mind on recordings and all that who probably didn't need to do Losing My Mind. Right. But you don't feel that with Phyllis. So Janie D was really fantastic. And actually, obviously not this song, but Diana Rigg also. Get the right actress in there, you get the role done. And it's just that I think a lot of actresses, when they look at it initially, are thinking, well, the fun role or the great role or the big role is Sally. But actors who know themselves, I'm telling you, in about 10 years, I mean, she could play it now. That's the other thing. I always forget that they're like 50. Because my mom, she's like, wait, they're younger than I am. This is what they're like at that age. But at some point, Jane Krakowski is another one who would be a great Phyllis. Yeah. She would bring not just the sort of Phyllis-y vibe to it, but she also brings some of that vitality. And there are so many actors who would make great Phyllises. And I feel like their initial glance at the script would tell them, oh, no, if you want to be in the show and you want the prestige, whenever you play Sally. But Phyllis, for the right actress, and they know who they are, Phyllis is a money role.
Yeah, absolutely. Victoria, thank you so much for taking the time out of your day to talk with me here today. For people who want to like stay in contact with you, see what you're up to, what is the easiest way for them to do that?
Well, the easiest thing is Instagram. I am at the Victoria Gordon. You can also check me out on Twitter. I am The Victoria Live. I do a show every other Sunday, definitely, on Twitch, which is 30 minutes and 5 songs. And you can find out all the details if you go to my Instagram or my Twitter. Otherwise, stay in touch with the podcast because Kyle knows where to find me.
Yeah, exactly. Perfect. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for listening. You can send emails to puttingittogetherpodcast@gmail.com. Also, you can follow Sondheim Podcast on Twitter and Instagram, and you can help support the show and help it to grow by going to patreon.com/puttingittogetherpodcast. Thank you to the Alberta Podcast Network and to ATB this week. Putting It Together is available on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and pretty much anywhere you can get podcasts from. Consider subscribing so that you never miss an episode. Next week, we'll be talking about Awe But Underneath. I know it was wrong, but the feeling's so strong. As always, a big thanks to the great Chris Taniguchi, who designed the podcast artwork, and to Nick Driscoll for composing our theme music. Well, we've reached the end of our episode. Yes, I know. Goodbye for now.
Exactly.
No,
let's not. That's not. Can I?
It's loud in French.
Oh, here we go.